Thank you. I ran into Kiko as I was leaving, and I apologize for being late. And he said that when he presented everything, he lavished great praise on his colleagues and such. And I said, well, you know, I will attempt to do the same and such. You know, though many people are going, well, first of all, good morning. Thank you for your service, and thank you for coming to Washington, D.C., but more so what you do day in and day out to promote the best interests of San Antonio. With anyone that represents San Antonio in Congress, that is their charge. You know, all politics is local and such, but no one else was elected to represent the 20th Congressional District. You've heard me say before, though, that sometimes, it was what Dick Gephardt told me when I first got here in 1999, you vote your conscience first, which is really the national interest in most cases, of course. You vote your district second, and then you vote your party third. And that has been a really great rule. And Dick Gephardt said, that's going to make my life miserable, because when I need you, you're going to tell me it's about your conscience or it's going to be about your district. And he was absolutely right. But thank you for what you do. And the other night, again, I really appreciate, you know, Nelson getting up there and his kind words and you sponsoring the tribute. It was heartwarming. And it's bittersweet, you know, and it'll probably dawn on me what it really means to be leaving Washington in public office. But I think it's the right time to do these things. I want to just keep the remarks rather brief. I've heard that you were going to have a couple of other really interesting speakers that may not be addressing you. And so if we have some time, I would love to answer a question or two. But I guess what I, you know, San Antonio, what are its strengths? What are its weaknesses? You have to make a living there. You promote your business there. You locate in San Antonio. So we have to make sure that it is an attractive business environment. But really, I mean, San Antonio, if you really think in terms of what is it that you really will always require to attract and keep business and to continue to grow, and it's never been all that difficult for me, and that is you need electricity. So you need a good supplier of electricity. And this is so basic, but we lose sight of these things. We need water. You need water and you need electricity. And you don't have those things, doesn't matter. You're not going to grow and you're not going to prosper. I think we're well served. I think we're forward thinking in those particular areas. And the other thing, of course, you need transportation. I'm very concerned about transportation. I know Terry is here. We've had discussions before because it does impact, of course, the ability to promote and conduct commerce. But it's also quality of life. And, you know, how much time do you spend commuting? I mean, there are repercussions and consequences to all of this. So I'm just going to go, what is SADC? And, I, you know, Yesenia and I have had these discussions before because of her experience with the chamber and, of course, her serving Senator Kay Bailey Hutchinson. And the value of the VITS is from San Antonio once a year, but throughout the year. Obviously, I see you throughout the year, and to make sure that we connect when I get back to San Antonio. It's really not that hard for members of Congress to identify the priorities. Because if we have Commissioner's Court, and if we have City Council, because, I mean, they're there day in and day out, and we are over here physically more often than we are back home. So if we take the lead of our county officials, our city officials, and then, of course, our civic and business leaders that obviously are discussing the issues with the city and the county, then we identify the priorities. The next thing that you must do, and I mean, you know this blueprint because you've been following it for a number of years, but I think you really have to redouble your efforts in the present political climate. And I don't know how long we're going to be in this political climate. You need to educate the delegation. You're going to have certain members that are going to represent portions of San Antonio, and you're going to have one member that is going to represent nothing but San Antonio. I'm not happy with the redistricting map. I think you're going to have to take in consideration competing interests by the individual, and I believe it is going to be Joaquin, who basically is not going to represent the economic heartland of San Antonio or seats of government. And I've had this discussion with Terry, and it's going to be a little more difficult for whoever replaces me to promote San Antonio because you will have conflicts. Because you're going to have another large metropolitan area that also has transportation needs. also has needs for energy, also has needs for water. Just so, those are just starting with the basics. And so this is truly uncharted territory for the first time in the history of San Antonio at the federal level. And we can go into the politics if you want to. I'm not going to do that. I'm just telling you my experience and what I shared with the court was you cannot do that to San Antonio. And I haven't seen specifically what they've done in this map that they came out with yesterday. But it's going to be really tough, I think, for the next member of Congress to be that unifying force and to carry a clear, concise, very San Antonio-specific, San Antonio-centric package of legislative initiatives. The other members have to share, right? Whether you're going into Laredo, whether you're going into El Paso, but now we'll be going into Austin. And that's a different animal. That is totally a different species. Because we are in competition with Austin. We love Austin. We understand the 35 corridor. But let me tell you something. We're fighting for that same dollar. And so when that member of Congress endorses one request or one grant, he or she may still have to endorse a competing city's grant. And I'm telling you right now, that's about effectiveness, and I think it will be impacted. So that's just a word of caution so you understand that. You educate the delegation, and then the next thing that many of you have finally figured out for a number of years and have done it really well, you figure out what the strategy is and where the specific tactics that you will be utilizing with the delegation. You pick one member to run with a certain issue that agrees to run and be the point person. And you identify the staff member on that member's staff that's going to be your point of contact so that you monitor it and that you keep on top of it and so that it doesn't get lost because we're overwhelmed and we are understaffed. Right, Jeff? You remember your days on the Hill. That's the formula that y'all have been following for some time. Do not abandon it. Now, some things have changed. I just told you about the composition of the delegation, and it's nothing that cannot be overcome if we do this right. But one thing that you cannot overcome, and that is presently where we are in the budgetary wars here, and the investment of the government dollar. You know, I told you the other day that a recent study showed that about 22% of employees work for companies that have federal contracts. That's of our entire employee population. In San Antonio, many of you probably, and I can't give you the percentage, what percentage of our economy is really dependent on a federal dollar? Is that a bad thing? Look, too much of anything is bad. That's the issue, and that should be the debate. And we have to figure out where we're positioned. So when the dollars start drying up, because they're going to dry up at the state level too, and you're going to be left with the county and the city as your main source without much help coming from the federals or the state. And that's a whole new ballgame, and it's going to be highly competitive. I think we'll prevail. One, because we have such an investment in San Antonio already. And so you plus up where you already have investment and infrastructure. So I think we're well positioned. It's not a guarantee. So we have to be careful and we have to be incredibly strategic. The other thing is just overall, the way I see San Antonio as I leave Congress, the issues have only grown more complex, more difficult, because we haven't really addressed them. And there are three major issues for San Antonio. And the first one is education. If we're not producing any more quality high school graduate, first of all, we have to produce a high school graduate. But if we're not producing a quality high school graduate, then how do you compete with other cities that may be doing it a lot better than we are? Look, we cannot continue to bus people in from Austin to work in a San Antonio firm. Can't do that. It's only a matter of time before, as a business person, you're going to be bussing in your employees 78 miles. You know what I'm talking about. And it's happening. And I'm not sure that we've got an answer at this point. And it does do with our school districts, our board of trustees, but it is the business community that should always be the leader in this. And Tom Frost Sr. was the epitome of what a business leader can do when it comes to these things. And it's not to say that we don't have others that are following in Mr. Frost's place, but I just don't think that we have the focus, the energy, and the investment to make changes and hold people accountable and help our kids. The other is health. We don't want to talk about that either, do we? We don't. But it is not good for San Antonio. And I know recently I read where we're not the fattest city in the United States anymore. We're one of the top 20 fittest. How that happened, I have no idea. Because it didn't happen, that's why. It didn't happen. And if you keep looking at the rates of obesity and the consequences of that, we're in bad shape in the state of Texas, and we're in really bad shape in the city of San Antonio. Now, there's an effort being made, and I'm proud of that effort. But boy, I mean, you know, somehow we've got to give these families the guidance, the education, the means, and the ability to pursue healthier lifestyles. You cannot be going in the direction that we're going today in this country, but especially in San Antonio, without dire, dire consequences, whether it's going to be diabetes or cardiovascular problems. I mean, these are real obvious. And these are they long-term? Of course they are, but we've got to be working on them day in and day out. Lastly, I'm going to go back to transportation. Let's not kid ourselves. It's not fun driving out 281 past 1604. Now, we may have built up all these areas, but we've got issues, IH-10. We've got issues at 281. We've got huge issues with IH-35. And how realistically are we really addressing them? And it's more than just quality of life. These are real big issues. And, I mean, you can say it's your elected officials, but the guidance comes from the business community. Because you have to basically tell us, we're going to dry up. We're not going to be growing in the right way unless we address all of this. So this is something that, you know, it really, really concerns me. On the national level, and I'm going on a little longer than I was expecting to, but these are just the concerns. I'm just giving you the big bird's eye view, what's changed, what hasn't changed, what we need to be doing, and so on. Now, hopefully, we're going to snap out of whatever we're in presently in this country, and we're going to start talking a little more rationally. You're going to need members of Congress that are willing to put their careers on the line to do the right thing. You're going to have individuals that want to run to office to tell the truth and survive a primary, which is not easy. And especially now with what's going to happen with the super PACs and such. My impression is in about 4 to 6 years, the Supreme Court is going to have to revisit some major decisions, and they're going to have to tweak them to allow some sort of regulation. Last July, when we were hemorrhaging over here at the end of July, we were going to default. Remember the debt ceiling debate? I spoke to the chamber in August about it. The best quote was, everybody didn't know what it meant, but people were scared. So they interviewed this 81-year-old retiree, and he just didn't understand this debate. But, I mean, what could it mean for the United States? I mean, was it really the end of the world and everything else? And he said, this is what he said, I used to be a cautious optimist, but now I'm a confused pessimist. And that's where we are today. We are a confused, pessimistic country. All of my life, and this is painful to admit, all of my life, you know, I was brought up, Dad was just, a force of nature and everything else, but he always said, we went to visit someone's home, we stayed there, to always leave it nicer than you found it. Remember that? If you work somewhere and you leave it, you're leaving it better than you found it. I leave Congress with a Congress not better than when I got here. And how much personal responsibility can you... I have to figure out, I'm part of that equation. I did not stop things from happening. Now, 435 members, the seniority system, a lot of stuff. The rank politics, the partisanship, and so on. But it cannot continue. You read yesterday, or you're reading today, that Olympia Snow is not going to seek re-election. This is not good for this country. That's all I can tell you. And it is true what I told you the other day at dinner. Suddenly, to be attacked for being a moderate... Now, a lot of people don't consider me a moderate, and I understand that. I am a partisan. I am a Democrat. I believe in our agenda. I believe in the philosophy. I know I am a Democrat. But that doesn't mean that I don't know what it is to compromise. You've got to compromise. But now, as we've said, compromise is a dirty word. Being a moderate is unacceptable. You can't get out of a primary by being a moderate. You're marked. I'm hoping all that will change. And the other day, I think there is a way out. But we have to have faith in ourselves. And the hard questions have to be posed. And when someone tells you, I'm presenting a budget that's going to do all these things, you have to look at it carefully. I'll be going to a markup of a bill where there's one part of the Affordable Care Act, also known as Obamacare, that would be repealed. All right, I'll consider that. Tell me what you replace it with. Nothing. Nothing. It's not just to oppose, you have to propose. We're not having that anymore. There is not that discussion. It used to be where people would oppose something and offer an alternative. Now, we're not doing that anymore. But you can demand that of your public officials. And you can ask the hard questions. And you can, yeah, I was just looking the other day, which is really curious, President Obama's budget. I mean, you've already heard. An acceptable debt to GDP ratio should be 60%. You should never have debt that exceeds 60% in the perfect world. Worldwide standards. How many countries have less than 60% debt to GDP ratio is interesting. But we know that President Obama's budget, if you project it for 10 years, will increase debt to 80% of GDP. Now, that should concern you. Concerns me. But you also know that if you look at Governor Romney's bill, or projected budget over 10 years, it will increase it closer to 90% of GDP. If you look at Rick Santorum's, it'll be 104% of GDP in 10 years. And if you look at Newt Gingrich, it's 114% of GDP. These aren't Democratic analysts that have looked at this. This is a bipartisan group of people that have served in both in Republican and Democratic administrations. What I'm trying to say is what I said to you back in August. We can get back on the road, but it's going to take some hard decisions. And one size will not fit all, and it has to be multifaceted, and you know that. And the only thing that's working in our favor right now is that, for the most part, the other countries are in worse shape. Everything is, you know, how, oh, woe is me, you know, it's the United States. But then you say it's compared to whom and what. And right now, because of what's going on in the European Union and such, we have a chance to really be viewed as much more responsible and stable. And Germany's going to be going into a recession. And we'll see what they do. We can't allow Greece. I mean, if Greece defaults, and then you've got problems with Spain and Italy and so on. But this is the time for the United States to be viewed as responsible and willing to make hard choices. You reduce spending, but you got to raise revenue. And I've been telling you this for over 2 years. And if you can't vote for someone who is saying that it's going to take raising revenue, then you relegate this city and this United States to continued deficits and an ever-increasing budget, and our debt percentage to GDP ratio will be 100%. It will be 104%. And I understand that a healthier economy will result in greater revenues. I'm all for that. But you just can't pull back suddenly. But these are just big thoughts that are going on out there. It's a presidential year. I'm hoping that there'll be a more honest debate once we get past the primary, and we'll see where the proposals really are, which are not defined in the primary debate, because that's a very narrow audience. And everybody will tell you, any given election year, you can count about 38% of people that are going to vote for the Republican, 38% that are going to vote for the Democrat. You can't win them. You can't win with just either group like that. It's a lot of other people that make up the difference to get to 50% plus. But I just want to say, I look at the message I just gave and I see the glum faces. I don't want you to have the glum faces. I want you to say, you know what, Charlie? I agree with some of the stuff you say, disagree with others, but I know that we've got issues and we've got problems, but doggone it, since when have we simply thrown our hands up and said we can't fix things? This is unbelievable. And when have we ever said, I'm not going to listen to you because I know I'm absolutely right 100%? When have we ever done that? I mean, in my short history, it's never really happened. And we've been partisan before. Believe me, I'm a Democrat. But I still know that people like John Dingell understands what compromise is all about, who has a healthy respect for the institution of Congress, and still believes that government has a real purpose for the people. Because it's like I've told you, Barney Frank says, what's government? Oh, it's when a group of people get together and want to do something as a group. That's who we are. But I just, thanks for all the support you've always given me. But more than anything else, thank you for the guidance that you have provided me and my staff. And Julie Hart is back over there. Julie's been with me for a number of years. I've had tremendous staff. I keep telling them that try to stick with me until the end of the term, because I'm already losing. Well, I've lost one, because I mean they're so talented that people aren't waiting; they're just coming and basically taking them to the private sector or to the administration. But that's the kind of quality people I've just been blessed to have. My San Antonio office, you should know them well because they've been there for a number of years, and they are such really true public servants. It really hurts me when they're demonized. The federal workforce is so demonized because it's not an 8-to-5 job. You know, you see me on a weekend, I've got a staff member, don't I? You know. So again, I just want to say thanks for everything. Richard, thank you for everything that you do for me, and thanks to the chamber, but thanks to everyone, the SA to DC.